What's going on, people, and welcome to Man Knows Football. You're here with myself, Gooney, and Matisse. This time it is not live, it is a pre-record. Definitely trying to mix it up a bit. I will be going live at some stage either today or tomorrow with Eunice to do part two of the transfer news episode that we were discussing yesterday. So definitely stay tuned for that. But for now, it feels like forever since I've had Matisse here on the channel. But welcome back. After a couple voice notes, I've managed to pull him away from his lovely summer that he's having over there and back into the Man Knows Football space. How are you doing, my bro?
I'm good, bro. There's a lot going on. Struggling to keep up with it all, but it's happening. Do you know what I mean? There's just every day there's just a new link, a new report. It's interesting though. I do like what we're looking at, but yeah, I'm glad there's no football. I'd much rather this than watching Chelsea back in the last season. So I'm happy, man.
No, 100%. Yeah, we can both agree that we're happy this season's done. Obviously, we got our third place Champions League secure. Now it's really just about the transfer window. But at the beginning of the transfer window, I did say to the to my subscribers and that I'll be trying to put out something daily. But you see, and especially it depends which sources you use. If you use a source that reports things early and they tend to be right, you end up just recycling information every day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's just like, I'm not trying to do that just to get the extra views or to insult anyone. Yeah, I just feel like it's not necessary. So I've been a bit on and off with it. But I think that's just how it's going to have to be during this summer until it gets to more of a
busier
period. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly that. So I think the people then will understand. Also, as well, before we do get into the main topics, I do have to plug it because we are under 100 subscribers away from that 10K number. I believe it's under 80 now or something like that. But we are literally right there on 10K. Let's see if we can make it by the end of today or possibly even tomorrow. You get me? Subscribe, share, like, all of that good stuff. All the interactions do help. But Matisse, let's get into the main news. And we'll start off with some of what Matt Law has said in his article. And I'm going to be careful to not read too much and violate this because this is behind the paywall. But it does say about Thomas Tuchel being promised that he can take the lead in Chelsea's transfer business. And that's been apparently confirmed by the club's new owners. Sort of go towards the Manchester City and Liverpool models. Now, I am paraphrasing from the article without reading it word for word, but have I summarized that correctly?
Yeah.
So
without pissing them off.
Yeah. Trust me, just trying to stay within acceptable limits in that. Trust me. But let's just start off with that because we've had this conversation before in terms of, you know, transfer policies going forward and whether it's a good idea for clubs to be catering to just one manager. So I just wanted to get your thoughts behind all of that.
Well, for me, you know, I would rather we have what we need in place in terms of a director of football, in terms of the scouts, in terms of everybody around Tuchel to help him do his job. You know, this guy is coming off the back of a very stressful season. We know that he split from his wife, all the craziness that was happening with the club, not easy to deal with, so many different scenarios and situations with board level players, etc., contracts running out, high pressure games to manage and sort. So it would be nice if he would have taken a break. It seems like as if he's not taking a break. That was what was reported. Is that if anything, he's kind of diving into his work even more, maybe as a distraction. Which is kind of sad, but it's understandable as well at the same time. And a lot of people have said to me, listen, well, you know, we have no other choice. And that makes sense because they've only just come in. They can't get the director of football that completely aligns with him for this summer. And then for them to go and assess the whole squad, for them to set up everything that they need to set up in terms of their recruitment, their scouting, their network, for that to all be set up when the deal was really only just done, you know, what, a couple of weeks ago, is impossible, right? So we're probably not going to see any of that until next summer, hopefully, some sort of, you know, structure. So right now it's all on Tuchel. And it's a lot of pressure for him because he's not a scout, but, you know, this is the manager's dream, I guess, to build your own team, you know, if they're going to 100% back him, but it is going to all fall on his shoulders. And then he will be, you know, he will be judged on his own signings because there is now no room for confusion about board signing, Tuchel signing. It is going to be Tuchel signings. That's what's being said anyway. So I'm looking forward to it, but you know, it looks like we're going to be going with existing targets or targets that we were already looking at anyway. And then obviously we go from there. So it's not too bad, I guess, but I'm just hoping Mourinho doesn't she doesn't get too forceful on what she wants to do and yeah. push her thing, and I yeah. want my money back and all, like, bro.
Yeah,
enough of that now.
that's one of my huge concerns. I mean, look, if it is rumored to be true that this is her final window, first of all, I completely understand it because the transition needs to be done. We can't just completely cut off the whole backroom staff and just have a new set of people in. No business can operate really like that. It rarely works. So I think this is the safe option to have. It's sort of a situation where, like, you know, is Marina my first choice in overseeing this transfer window? Absolutely not. But also as well, because I see quite a few fans on social media slightly getting ahead of themselves because they don't quite understand things and they don't quite read into things. So, for example, like, look, we're linked with a lot of exciting players. Obviously, Ousmane Dembele looks like the one who's closest to sign, as well as Koundé. Yeah. But we also have to bear in mind that Chelsea are still operating on this one in and one out policy. So the outgoings are going to be just as important as the incomings. And that's another worry that I do have, because, again, just going back to the point like you made on Marina and whether her ego is going to get in the way, the first player we're actually going to talk about, it's a good way to segue into it, is actually Romelu Lukaku, because we know how hard that she worked on the deal to get him here in the first place. 100 million, you know, biggest transfer fee ever paid on a player by Chelsea. It's a huge amount of pressure, you know, for even her, you know, because she's got a lot to answer to. So now she's under pressure. She's being asked to be part of these negotiations with Inter Milan. I see the structures that are slowly coming out on social media. Personally, I'm still quite skeptical about the whole thing going through. But let's just start there with Romelu Lukaku and some of the things that we've seen reported. So what are your thoughts on all of this? Do you realistically see him moving by the end of this window?
He has to move. Is it realistic? In some ways, yes. In some ways, no. But there's a lot in, that goes into it in terms of wage, you know, duration, player swap,
yeah,
money, loan fee. There's a lot. But my God, we have to get it done. We have to get him out of this football club. Preferably, you know, with a loan with an obligation to buy, or 2-year loan, 20 million this year, 20 million next year.
Yeah.
Something, I don't really care how it gets done. It has to get done, though. You know, if we're talking about Inter Milan can't afford him, but they want him back, he wants to go back, slap a 20 million loan fee. That's the first bit. I was joking on Twitter that they should cancel their direct debit, because apparently we haven't even paid the whole fee. Do you know what I'm saying? In terms of,
yeah, it's installments.
It was installments. Bro, just stop paying, bro. It's like a gym membership. Just stop. Do you know what I'm saying? But if that's not possible, which I'm sure it's not legally, then We have to get a loan fee. If we can't get an obligation to buy it, and he apparently wants a 2-year loan, then get a loan fee for this year, get a loan fee for next year, or put a very valuable player swap in there as well. If Bastoni's valued around 50 million, then slap him in, plus the loan fee, that's 70 mil. Take it and leave it. Let's just take that and get out. Do you know what I mean? We have to get a player involved. We have to get a loan fee, and we have to get him out of this football club. And it needs to be permanent. I don't want him to come back next summer. I don't want him to come back the summer after. I want him back. That's done. I want him out of the football club. Finished.
Yeah, 100. I've got to agree with that. I mean, the situation now should be completely untenable for Lukaku. The way he behaved, I mean, even with that interview early in the season, I've said several times at that point, mentally, I'd already cut ties with the player, and I could only see one way this was going to go. Yeah. But, you know, to further just worsen the flames, to just be going out there and actively just talking to Inter Milan and trying to, you know, force a move back. If that is rumored to be true, and speaking to the other players and saying, I'm coming back to help you win the Scudetto and this and that, then that, when you talk about professionalism, something that I thought that he had in abundance coming into the club, he's just been the complete polar opposite. But you did mention one of their players. Now, the rumor has come out that, you know, Inter are prepared to offer a loan agreement, and it is 20 million euros, like you said, I believe, plus I believe it's either Bastoni, Lautaro Martinez and Skriniar to loan one of those three players, or is it on a permanent? I don't know. I haven't actually seen.
It would have to be a permanent.
Because that's the only way it would make sense to me, obviously. But in terms of those players, that are available. Let's start off with Lautaro Martinez, because he's the closest like for like, if you want to put it that way, out of the three. Obviously, was Lukaku's partner, could arguably play his best football alongside Lukaku. It's based on a couple of reasons why I don't think that move there will happen. I think the whole point, one of the main reasons Lukaku wants to go back, is to get that link up with Lautaro Martinez again. So for him to be involved in a swap deal going the other way, I think that slightly defeats the purpose of a lot of this. And I don't even think Lautaro wants to leave Inter. He said several times he wants to stay. He wants to try and, you know, get the Scudetto back from the red side of Milan and bring it back to the blue. All of that good stuff, you get me? Yeah. So I don't see him leaving. Now, in terms of the other two, Bastoni, I've said several times, he's a player I would love to have at Chelsea Football Club. Out of the young centre-backs that we are targeting that are left-footed, he would have been my number one choice.
Yeah.
But the way it's looking, Tottenham are in pole position. They are strong favourites to sign the player. Obviously, the relationship between Antonio Conte and him previously at Inter Milan and the Italian connection, it makes sense for him to go over there. And also, he's been offered a decent amount of football there. Mm. But for me, if there's any way we can sort of step in like we used to in the old school and sort
of muscle wonderful.
Still, I would be over the moon.
Mm. Oh, 100%.
I'd be over the moon. But do you see this realistically being a possibility? Like, what do you think of the three players in particular that we're linked with coming our way?
I think Skriniar is the favourite for me because it seems like reportedly that's the one they want to offer first. Also, apparently the agents of Skriniar and Bastoni have just arrived in Milan offices, I guess, to discuss who would like to make the swap, you know, who would be open to it, etc., what the player wants. So that's interesting. I think Bastoni, if we were to get Skriniar, would that put more pressure on Tottenham for Bastoni in terms of would Inter Milan want to lose two of their centre-backs in a three? Would they make them pay more? So regardless of who we go for, as long as we get one before they do, then our lives are easier, whether it's Skriniar, whether it's Bastoni. That puts pressure on Tottenham and they may not get the guy that they want because of, you know, either we've taken him or because they don't want to lose two centre-backs in one go. Or they'll just charge more, which is, I guess, similar to what potentially could be happening with Carlos at Sevilla now. Couldn't they? We need him, you know.
Yeah.
It's a similar situation. Martinez, absolutely, for me, is not going to happen.
Yes. I think,
listen, they want Dybala. Can they get Dybala, Lukaku and Martinez? It would be a lot. But I don't think Martinez wants to leave. And I don't think, you know, Martinez, one of the big reasons why Lukaku wants to go back there is because of Martinez. So,
yeah,
it's that link up. So, and I think Martinez wants to stay. So I don't really see that happening, nor would I be a massive fan of it as well. I think for me, you know, we should be probably looking at someone like Gabriel Jesus over Martinez just because he's in the league. He's done it. Do you know what I mean? Yes, his statistics people will say could be better, but he's what, 25, going to be coming into his prime now. He's going to adapt far faster. He could play across the front line and he's good technically. So that's the person I would favour. And we've been linked with him as well. So I think it will be one of the centre-backs if it's anyone, to be honest.
Lovely for it to be Bastoni. Who would you choose between the two? Skriniar, Bastoni?
It's tough, man, because both of them are quality players. If we get Skriniar, he's been playing on the right side of the defence. So that would tell you in a back three, he would be best on the right. He's right-footed. That's where he's been playing this season. Mm-hmm. He's been brilliant. He's been one of the best centre-backs probably in the world on that right-hand side for them. You know, they've got an incredible defensive record. I think only bettered by Napoli and Milan, and it's 31 to their 32. But he's been on that right-hand side. He's kind of like an old-fashioned Ivanovic, but he's still a ball-playing centre-back, so he's got modern-day traits to him as well. Body on the line. He's a defender's defender. Bastoni is younger, 23. So age-wise, I'd prefer Skriniar because we do need experience, I feel, in the back line. Bastoni's, what, 23? He's younger. He's got a lot of potential. Had a very, very, very good season. Unbelievable season for him. And he's that left footer. He's the one that goes down the left hand side, and we need the left. We need the left hand side as well.
Can also play left wing back too. And left back.
So it's difficult. It's very difficult because we need both. If we're getting Koundé, that's the right side sorted. You would then need the left. If you're getting Koundé, that's the age range of a young defender. you kind of need an older one. So it's a little bit messy. Do you know what I mean? It's not really perfect. Can Skriniar play on the left-hand side of a back three? I don't know. I don't know if he's able, from a ball-playing aspect, if he's able to bring the ball out and be as effective as he is on the right, because he's brilliant on the right, bringing the ball out. Good carrier of the ball. Very aggressive in everything he does. Can he do that on the left? We've seen Rudiger do it. So it's not out of the question that he can. And obviously, I still want to give Colwell some sort of path. Do you know what I mean? I don't want the player ahead of him to be too young, where now it's a straight dogfight constantly, because that's not going to work. So, to be honest, whichever one wants to be here as well is important. Whichever one wants to actually come, because we need to get rid of Lukaku. I'll get rid of Lukaku for anyone. Do you know what I'm saying? So whichever one wants to be here, then we go with that one, and then we worry about... These are very small things, do you know what I mean? Who plays on what side, age. Yes, they're important, but when it comes to Lukaku, they're minuscule in comparison, because getting that toxic player out of our football club is more important than which centre-back we get out of these two, because these two are both great centre-backs. So whichever one comes in is going to improve our back line with what we've currently got, which is basically nobody... and then we sort out the details from there.
I mean, I'm now just trying to figure out a little transfer merry-go-round in my head. I mean, as Piliquetta, we don't know what's going on with him. We know Tuchel does want to keep him, so they probably will offer him a contract. It's just down to whether he will sign it, so we've got to keep an eye on that. Yeah. Marcus Alonso pretty much is one foot out the door, but Barcelona's financial situation still remains to be seen whether that move's even feasible for them. So potentially that's two extra players out the door. One obviously is a left wing back / very poor left back in Marcus Alonso. So would I pick that Bastoni specifically directly for that position? I wouldn't. I'd more favour him as that left centre back, or even a left centre back in the back four as well. So that's where I would primarily play him. I believe that's his best position. Can do a job out wide. I'd pick him, but my problem is, it's just like you said, it's that Koundé situation, bro. And I'm also a huge, huge fan of, you know, bringing in a Koulibaly rather than Matthijs de Ligt into this club, who, if I'm being completely honest with you, I think he's quite overrated, and I'm not too keen on bringing him into the club for the reasons as well that you stated. But, okay, so if Lukaku doesn't go to... Inter Milan, according to ES Grimes, he would be open as Bayern Munich as a fullback. Now, we know the situation with Lewandowski over there is looking to be untenable, but whether Bayern Munich will want to make an example out of him and keep him an extra season against his will, which is something that I've seen reported, is something that remains to be seen. But if Lewandowski goes, they need a striker. And the reported price that they're willing to pay is 70 million euros. And Lukaku wouldn't necessarily have to take as much as a pay cut as he would going to Inter Milan. Although we know it's more than monetary reasons why Lukaku wants to go back to Milan. But apparently he is open to that move, and that is according to ES Grimes again.
There's other reports saying that he's not open to anyone outside of Milan.
Okay.
I'd be shocked if Bayern Munich go for Lukaku, man, with the way that they recruit... The way that they look at players,
I'd be shocked as well.
I'd be absolutely shocked. They've just watched this guy trample all over our football club within the space of 6 months of signing. They've also now got their talisman who's talking a lot in the press, and he would like to leave. He's making that very clear. I don't really anticipate they want much more drama on top of that coming in. I'd be shocked. I really would. Nagelsmann is in charge. From what I'm aware of, he likes to press from the front. I don't know why. Well, at least that's what he did before. I don't know why he would bring in someone like Lukaku over someone like Timo Werner. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you're Bayern Munich right now and you need a striker to fit Nagelsmann's, you know, profile, and Nagelsmann's already worked with a striker before. I'm not saying Timo Werner's the best option out there. I'd be lying. But if I was choosing a Chelsea striker to go for, if I'm Bayern Munich, I'd go Timo Werner. Timo Werner's literally
100%.
Done it. He's already done it in the Bundesliga already. Do you know what I mean? He's shown that he could do it already. His motivation will be ridiculous because of obviously that World Cup coming up with Germany. It makes more sense. He's worked with him before. You know he's going to give you the work rate from the top of the pitch. He's younger. He's on less wages. He's going to cost less. I don't understand... I don't understand why they would go for Lukaku. It makes no sense to me. So I don't think that will happen. I'll be shocked.
More likely Timo Werner. But either way, like, even the principle, does the principle still stand in the situation with Ousmane Dembele coming in, then one definitely having to go out? So if one of the wingers will be going now, I think possibly two could even leave. But who's the one that's looking most likely for you to leave at the minute?
Out of the wingers?
Yeah.
Can't tell. I'm not going to lie to you. I cannot tell. I think it's so up in the air. I'm going to be speaking about Hudson-Odoi later on, because I've got a little bit of info on that one and where that's going. But when it comes to Pulisic and Ziyech, it's a flip of a coin. I think Ziyech is probably the one that would be more likely, just because he's obviously just as unsettled. But Pulisic's got that American part where, yeah,
exactly.
You know, I just don't see this new ownership selling their American star boy asset when we're about to go on an American preseason tour. They are themselves American. And again, he's still a young player that, again, I don't feel like we've fully got everything out of. Do you know what I mean? There's still more to come. I personally wouldn't sell any of them. I'd maybe loan out Hudson-Odoi because I think he needs game time and I think we need goals from out wide. I know Hudson-Odoi's underlying metrics for creativity is decent or pretty good. But I wouldn't focus on that too much considering Dembele's coming in for creativity as well. We need goals. We need goals in this team. People are gonna go one way and they're gonna go ultra creative with no goals in the team.
Yep.
Which is what's gonna end up happening. Because when you lose a player like Lukaku, the guy can finish, you know. That's one thing. He can finish. Shocking in other departments, but he can finish. If we're gonna go with Kai Havertz down the middle, we need goals from out wide on one of them flanks. And Dembele's got one goal this season. So I'm looking at the other flank for goals now. And I can't have a flank over there relying upon Pulisic and Hudson-Odoi, those two as a combination for left wing for another season. Can't trust them. Not saying that they have potential. There's definitely, they could explode, but I'm not going to go into a season relying on them two at left wing. For me, you keep one, you bring one in, and you loan the other. I think Ziyech could easily be Dembele's deputy. But the thing is with Ziyech is he has to play out wide. If he's playing in this narrow front, there's no point. So you may as well sell him. So depends on the formation. If we're sticking to three at the back, you may as well look at selling him. If we're going with wingers, then maybe keep him. But for me, as I've been saying for months, Werner and Lukaku, they have to go.
In terms of wingers that are available, I know Gnabry is available this summer. As is apparently Sané is. I don't know how true that is, but apparently Sané is. obviously, Rafinha's.
I like Sané. Abs. Yeah.
But out of the players available, also there is Raheem Sterling and Gabriel Jesus. Jesus, we've already talked about. Raheem Sterling, we've spoken about too. He wouldn't necessarily be my first choice because, again, yes, he can get goals, but I do believe that a lot of that is based on Pep's system. But he can be frustrating in front of goal a lot of the time, Raheem Sterling. So for me, he wouldn't be first choice. Jesus, again, I'm still a bit undecided about him. I'm not saying he's a bad player. I'm just undecided about him at the minute. But if we're talking like a Gnabry or possibly Leroy Sané, because remember, the advantage of Ousmane Dembele is that he can use both feet very, very well. So to play him on that left flank is not an issue.
Yeah.
He can play there fine. So if it's a matter of bringing in a Sané who's strictly left-footed and putting him on that right wing, then cool. And even at Man City, Sané did play on the left wing, so it wouldn't even be an issue for him anyway. So Sané is one that I'm a fan of, but I'm hearing talks of, does he still have that hunger? Does he look bothered? Does he still want to win things? And personally, nobody can judge a player unless you know that person and their true intentions. But from what I've seen of him and what I know of him, and he's still, 25? Is he 26, 25? Roughly that age?
Yeah. Gnabry for me is... He looks more likely to go to maybe Liverpool as part of a Mane deal, maybe.
I think he goes Liverpool.
But, you know, I think Real Madrid have been linked to him as well. I think he's waiting out on maybe Real Madrid because they need a forward. They need a winger badly.
That's 2023, though, Real Madrid is saying, so they get him on a free transfer.
The only thing of Real Madrid is that they do need a winger. They're losing, I mean, they're keeping Hazard, they're losing Bale, they're losing Asensio, could be leaving, Isco's leaving, left. They definitely do need a winger. They were looking at Jesus for a period, but then EU restrictions, they can only have so many players outside the EU. So I think we're definitely not top of the food chain for Gnabry. But if Liverpool, say, get Nunes from Benfica, then maybe the door opens. And yeah, that for me, Gnabry can play both flanks. Dembele can play both flanks. You've got goals. You've got creativity.
Gnabry's a goal scorer, yeah.
I would love that. I would take that 100%. I would take that. They're at the right age. I would take that 100%. I would take that. Will it happen? Probably not. It's a bit too much of a dream, that one. Rafinha is a good player. You know, he'd be someone that maybe comes in if you was to get rid of a Ziyech. He's going to be expensive now. If Leeds have got relegated, he probably would have been already at Barcelona by now. I think Barcelona still won him, as you said. So again, not really top of the queue for that. Sterling, I'm not for. I think he's on stupidly high wages. He's also still going to cost a fair bit. I think he's earning like 300,000 a week. And wow. I do believe that his end product with his finishing is still... I mean, obviously, compared to the rest of our squad, it looks great. But I just don't feel like he's a player that I can rely upon to finish his chances, especially in a team that don't create as high quality chances as City. And I don't think just because we sign a couple of players, we're going to suddenly become Man City. If you look at their pass... I don't know if you saw their pass map. It went out the other day on Twitter. Their pass map is disgustingly good. Like, everything is so balanced. It's so symmetrical. It's just ridiculous the way they create. So... Who else is there? You know, you've got Nkuku, we're looking at, you've got a few different names. For me, Gnabry would definitely be the best one, but I don't think it will
happen. Financially, it would make the most sense as well.
Yeah, one year left.
So, yeah, you know, exactly. It's not gonna cost
a mad amount of money.
Chelsea should be really looking at that. But before you do leave, I did want to touch on the topic of Declan Rice. Now, I know he hasn't really been... discussed too much from what I've seen anyway, because a lot of Chelsea fans are of the belief that this summer it's impossible to sign him. West Ham are asking for too much money. But just going back to something that Matt Lord did say in his article, the ambitions of Chelsea's new owner mean that a bid for Declan Rice cannot yet be ruled out, given the fact Tuchel is known to be an admirer of the midfielder who West Ham have claimed to value at £150 million. Now, the thing is, in a previous article, Matt Lord did say to ignore that price tag. And I, although he didn't state numbers, I do believe like a deal at around between 80 and 100 million might just do it in terms of Declan Rice. Now, look, in terms of the price, we can argue till the cows come home whether it's too expensive or not. But at the end of the day, it's the new owners that make this decision and not us. We've just got to roll with the punches. If you feel, if the people out there feel a way about the price, that's on you. Personally, I feel it's a lot of money to spend on the DM. But I feel, again...
For too many just went for 100 million
this
euros.
This is what I'm saying. For the
85 million time, pounds.
We have put ourselves in a situation where we are forced to pay for quality. We cannot cheap out on this. Absolutely not. I'm not saying Sangare is a cheap option. I haven't seen enough of him to make a fair judgment on the guy. You get me? But we are heavily linked with him. But for me, I said, if Tchouameni is not coming through these doors, it's got to be Declan Rice. Do you feel that we will try and test the water with West Ham in terms of Declan Rice this summer?
No. I don't think we will. Again, another summer will go by for the third summer in a row where we are linked with this player. The only way we're going to get Declan Rice is if Declan Rice starts to push for the move. And the only way he's going to do that is if we put in an official bid. Somebody needs
to... in a transfer request or something.
Yeah, so somebody needs to blink first. We need a DM. I wouldn't be surprised if we did go and get somebody else who's cheaper. Because, you know, when you look at the outlay, I know they're saying they're going to spend money, but that's going to come at, you know, certain positions. You know, 80 million for one player. That's nuts. It's a lot of money. When you need two centre backs, when you need a forward, when you need
potentially a striker, yeah.
You need wing backs. If you're gonna keep the system, you need wing backs. It's a lot of money, man. It's a lot of money. And I'm not saying he's not worth it, but I don't think he's going anywhere. Man United won't get him, I don't think, because of this new Ten Hag you know, he's now in charge. I think he's been looking at De Jong. Don't know if that's going to happen, but I think they'll look at other people as well. Outside of that, I think he could end up easily staying there one more year. Unless he's going to push, then that price is going to have to come down next summer. So, yeah, I don't think we're going to get him. But if we do, it's going to be a lot of money because, you know, Tchouaméni just went for £85 million.
Facts.
We could have him for 40 last summer, but we decided to piss about, get Saúl Ñíguez, which is all on Marina and Tuchel together, not just on one. Mm-hmm. Apparently Tuchel was involved in that decision as well.
Yeah, so I hear as well.
So yeah, you know, we got to bite the bullet. Now, is he perfect? I don't think Declan Rice is perfect at all. I think he's good at some things. I think there's some things he needs to improve on. If we do get him, I think Mateo Kovacic and Billy Gilmore are very, very important. Very, very important. Both of them. People may snigger at Billy Gilmore, but he's very good in the first phase, very good at picking up the ball off the defenders, very good in tight spaces, very press resistant, wants the ball, wants touches, and that we'll need that for the build-up play. And I think Declan Rice is not there yet with his build-up play in comparison to those two. So those two will be very important. And then the rest of the midfield will sort itself out. But if he comes in, it's going to be very toxic online. I'm just going to try and stay clear of all that and just judge him as I see him. Do you know what I'm saying?
And I mean, yeah, there are several other options, but I'm sure, I know we're getting a bit tight for time. I don't want to keep you over, but other options that are there to discuss are players that we already own, you know, Ethan Ampadu, like you said, Billy Gilmore, two players there that can do a job in that position. It's just whether Tuchel's going to, you know, trust them in this squad. I mean, we do have 5 subs next season. So, look.
I think for me, both of those players are secondaries. I don't think we should be trusting them to start. Yeah. You know?
Would you be happy with Sangare coming in?
I don't know enough. I was talking to Eunice about this on All You Can Eat Chelsea. He brought him up, the Ivorian defensive midfielder. I've got mixed reports from people that watch him. They say his first touch can be a little bit loose, which is not something that I want to see. I do worry a little bit. I think off the ball, of course, you know, stature-wise, physicality-wise, he looks like as if he's going to be able to do good defensively off the ball, cover ground, etc. But on the ball, I don't know what his build-up play is like. I don't know if he's technically good enough in tight spaces. I don't know about that first touch. So I'm not co-signing it. No chance. I think the thing is with Rice is that he just actually needs to take more responsibility in deeper areas and say that I'm gonna be that guy. He needs to keep scanning. This is why, for me, Billy Gilmore is so important, along with Kovacic, because these guys are great scanners. They're aware of their surroundings. They want the ball in deeper areas, and they're good at it. So I'm not saying they're going to play the deepest position, but on the ball, they'll drop in. Maybe Rice vacates that position for a bit till he learns it, which he hasn't really had to learn at West Ham as much. And then off the ball, he drops in, you know what I mean? And they push up. I don't know. It's a pivot, you know, it's back and forth. I think on the ball in a pivot, Kova and Rice, Kova will drop in, take the ball. Billy will come in, take the ball. They'll be more dominant. Off the ball, we switch back over. Rice is the one, do you know what I mean? Maybe it works like that. We know Rice is a bit of a carrier. He likes to carry the ball, likes to get in a little bit further forward. So it can be interchangeable, but it's not perfect in terms of him as a DM. For me, the only perfect DM that we were looking at was Tchouaméni. I think Tchouaméni was, you know, he was able to do it all. He's cheaper, able to do it all. The only thing is adapting to the Premier League. But listen, I've seen players go from Premier League club to Premier League club and be shit. So doesn't mean they're going to do well just because they're in the Premier League already.
No, that's a fact. But on that, we're going to leave it. Matisse, what have you got on your channel or coming up on your channel?
Video dropping in a minute. Soon. I got to record it. That will be coming out today. I've got a collab with Rabona TV coming out, I think, tomorrow morning. I might put that out. That's talking about Nunes from Benfica, the striker. Getting some good analysis on him. He's a Benfica fan. And then probably another video will drop tomorrow evening. Maybe a double upload. You can eat Chelsea's tomorrow as well, actually. So, yeah, there's definitely going to be double uploads coming up. Yeah, a lot of content. And then on Twitch, we're watching Love Island. We said fuck the Nations League. We're just cussing. Love Island, Don. We're just cussing class. No, I'm not. This is my first episode I watched yesterday. If you can't beat them, join them, Goonie. Honestly. Bro,
I'm in America, so I'm good.
I was watching Nations League. It was dead, boring. Couldn't stand it. Love Island was. I was just cussing people. It was so entertaining. So we just said we're going to stream it on Twitch.
Yeah, no, it is what it is, man. Just especially when there's no club football going on.
International football is disgusting. Yeah, bro. Man, people are just pulling hammies.
Yeah, the people them know what we're talking about, man. No club football is absolutely killing me right now. I just want to fast forward, get the transfer window over and done with first game of the season already, man. That's how it goes. But over here at Man Knows Football, you already know what the mission is. We're trying to get to 10K finally. Listen, we're under 80 subs or so away from 10K. We can make this happen, man. Let's go. Let's push, man. Share the thing. Comment. Like, all of the interactions work, man. Trust me. Big up all yourselves to everybody that's been sharing, everybody that's been here from the mission. And welcome to the people who have just joined. Listen, I am absolutely fried as well. I just bun a zoo and I feel like I'm just waffling. But listen, you people know what I'm trying to say, innit? Big up everybody. It's love every single time. Matisse, good to have you back on here. Can't wait to have you back regular again. Start up with the next season, hopefully. Yeah. Hopefully, I'm not going to try and tie you into any promises now. I know later on down the line, so we'll see. We'll see. But it's always good to have Matisse on here. You get me? So big up yourself, Matisse.
100% in a bit, people.